Fantastic. So it's Tisha B'Av. I'm not supposed to offer words of welcome, but I do want to, first of all, thank everybody for participating on today's webinar. I say webinar only because it's a slightly different form of Zoom than we are accustomed to in our shul, but it will likely have the same feel as all the other Zoom presentations. And I want to express my hakaras hatov to Dr. Abramson, who has become, I would say, synonymous with Tisha B'Av, but in a good way, in Young Israel of Fort Lee, because what Dr. Abramson has done is he has brought Tisha B'Av to life in our shul. As I've said already a few times over the past few hours, Tisha B'Av is a very, very challenging day for the Jewish people. It's challenging because some of the emotions that we're supposed to feel on Tisha B'Av don't automatically arise just because it's the ninth day of Av. And it's a challenging day because many of the texts that we encounter, Megillas Eicha Mekinos, are not texts that we easily understand. And over the past few years, Dr. Abramson has been in our shul and has allowed so much of the Tisha B'Av experience to, as I said, to come to life, because he brings Jewish history to us in a very engaging and meaningful way. This year, Dr. Abramson and I were talking, planning for Tisha B'Av. We always end off Tisha B'Av together saying, next year we'll be in Yerushalayim, but if not, we'll have the opportunity to learn together. So a few weeks ago when Dr. Abramson and I were talking about this year's Tisha B'Av, as it seemed to be a reality that both will be in the exile, and also it'll likely be still in the midst of this global pandemic. So the idea surfaced that we would separate kinos in the morning with a lecture in the afternoon to give people some time to rest their eyes between the two events. And I really am thrilled, if that's the word to use on Tisha B'Av, but I really am thrilled that Dr. Abramson is joining us again to enlighten us and to engage in a meaningful study on this very challenging day. So b'kavod gadol, Dr. Henry Abramson.
Thank you, Rabbi. That's a very kind introduction. And I have to concur in all respects. Definitely my favorite place to be on Tisha B'Av would be Yerushalayim. And my second favorite place would be the Young Israel of Fort Lee. So I guess that means this is a galus betach galus. It's an exile upon exile that we have to be so far apart. But I am grateful for the opportunity to speak to your wonderful Kehillah again. I just hope that next time we speak, it will be in Yerushalayim, and we will have a revised version of this lecture, which has a grossly different ending. Let me share my screen here, and we'll go straight to the material itself. Now, let me just begin with a poll. This is something that we can do with this technology, which is kind of useful. I'm going to send out a poll to all of you, and I invite you to respond. You can just click on your screen at the appropriate point. Have you ever heard of the 1903 Kishinev pogrom? I'd just like to get a sense of what you all, what the background knowledge is of this community. And chances are many of you have, because Kishinev is one of the most notorious of the pogroms in all of Jewish history, and it had a uniquely powerful impact on the way in which we observe modernity. Okay, I'm going to give it three more seconds, so I have to decide right now, and then I'm going to release the poll to everybody. Okay, here we go. This is the result of our poll. It seems that 73% of you have in fact heard of the Kishinev pogrom, and 25% have not, and only 2% are in the not sure, don't know category. So clearly this is something for which everyone has at least some familiarity, and I think that will certainly help as we go through this material. So let's now try to understand why is it such a well-known pogrom? It is definitely the pogrom that changed the world. It had a phenomenal impact on the Jewish sense of exile. To echo what Rabbi Goldberg said in his comments, that, you know, we go through life day by day, quotidian lives, and we don't really necessarily feel the sharpness of galus. But Kishinev was one of those moments that all around the world, Jews suddenly felt that they are in galus, they're in exile. This is something different, and it is intolerable. It had a tremendous impact on Jewish self-image. As we shall see, one of the most difficult aspects of studying this particular pogrom is trying to understand what Jews could have done differently. And specifically, could they have fought back? Did they fight back? If they didn't, why didn't they? And so on. And so there's a huge movement towards greater militarization and military ability among Jews that results from Kishinev. It has a huge impact on Zionism, of course. A tremendous flood of Russian Jews in particular looked toward Israel as their new home, as they saw that living in the Russian Empire was no longer viable. And it also has a phenomenal impact on America. Surprisingly, as we shall see towards the end of this lecture, it actually has a very direct connection to the Black Lives Matter movement that we are so involved with today. Really, much of it dates to events that are associated with Kishinev. So this is definitely a pogrom that was something that created a consciousness among Jews, but also among non-Jews, of the fragility of galut, of exile, and exploring it, I think, will hopefully shed some light on these points. We're going to rely very heavily on Stephen Zipperstein's recent book, Punch and Tilt of History. The tilt of history part is, of course, the ramifications, the Rezeptionsgeschichte of the pogrom in the outside world, which were quite significant. And I'm grateful to Rabbi Goldberg for specifically suggesting I read it, because it was a very valuable source. And I definitely want to echo my gratitude for Dr. Zipperstein's tremendous scholarship in this lecture. Let us take a very small tour of pogrom violence and try to understand how Kishinev fits within the larger span of that. So what exactly is a pogrom? The term pogrom is relatively new. It basically dates from Kishinev. It is a Russian word, which is related to the words for lightning strike or thunder, in the sense of something that comes suddenly and attacks a small population. The 19th century, however, had lots of other words for pogrom, bezporiadke, which means like disorderliness. You had terms like riot, you had terms like upheaval. But pogrom is something that has become associated specifically with an attack on a Jewish population. It has been later used in a kind of grander sense. It's just like the term Holocaust is unfortunately sometimes bent to other purposes. But it really is associated very deeply with Jews, and in fact, probably entered the English language through Yiddish from Russian. And Jews using that term from Russian probably introduced it to English speakers. Typical features are a civilian Jewish population, not involved in any conflict whatsoever, are attacked by a quasi-military group, criminals, hooligans, but more commonly just regular villagers, sometimes peasants coming from outside of the village, as we shall see, sometimes day laborers traveling on trains, but rarely with any kind of military insignia. The pogrom as a form of violence, of course, goes back centuries upon centuries, but we're gonna focus on this one pogrom, which was especially noted for its violence. The number of Jews killed was 49. I mean, especially when you look at the scope of violence in the 20th century, Kishinev was just the very beginning in 1903. 49 is a very small number of deaths. God forbid, one death is huge. But compared to the pogroms that would erupt in 1905, in 1919, in the Holocaust, it was a tiny little blip on the screen. Here is a map, by the way, that shows you where Kishinev is. It's in the region today called Moldova. Then it was called Bessarabia, which was a part of the Russian Empire, bordering Romania on the west and Ukraine on the east, and with an indigenous population known as Moldovans. It's called Chisinau in contemporary terms. And today, its greatest claim to fame is probably that it is one of the great networking centers of human trafficking. So if we look at pogroms historically, the first recorded pogrom that I can think of that sort of meets these parameters occurred in Alexandria, Egypt in the year 38. And this had to do with a lot of geopolitical factors, and the Jewish population in Alexandria was exerting some of its own sort of flexing its own muscles in certain ways, and there are certain elements going on in the Roman Empire that cause a general riot. This happens to be, and it was directed specifically at Jews as victims. This happens to be probably the earliest pogrom, at least that I can think of. We have many smaller pogroms like this, but perhaps one of the most significant is the pogroms that occurred in the First Crusade in the winter of the First Crusade began in 1095, but the pogroms occurred in the spring and summer of 1096. And this is when crusaders decided that they would rather not travel all the way from Europe down to Israel and attack infidels, in that case Muslims. They would rather simply attack infidels closer to home, and so they attacked the Rhineland Jewish communities of Speyer, Worms, and Mainz, wreaking horrible havoc in those populations and making an indelible mark on Ashkenazi culture that we commemorate every Shabbos when we read the prayer Av HaRachamim specifically. Pogroms as a form of violence escalated throughout the High Middle Ages, especially with the growth of the belief in the noxious idea of the blood libel, which was this bizarre notion that also has its involvement with Kishinev, that somehow the Jews need to kill and torture and bleed dry a Christian boy in order to properly celebrate Passover. This is a medieval woodcut later with color added of the martyrdom of Simon of Trent, later made a saint by the Catholic Church, who was supposedly kidnapped and tortured and murdered by Jews. Even though this is a complete falsehood, a total lie, Jews simply do not do anything like this. We have no instance where Jews were involved in anything like this, despite anti-Semitic comments to the contrary. Nevertheless, it had a lasting impact on the popular psyche, and blood libel rituals or blood libel calumnies surrounded Jewish communities throughout Eastern Europe through much of the Middle Ages. It still is very much alive today, as you can see in this horrendous depiction by Giovanni Gasparo that was just released in February of this year, a modern day representation of the martyrdom of Simon of Trent, which has obviously met with great condemnation around the world, but nevertheless, just an indication of how, you know, deep-seated these pathological beliefs are. So with blood libel charges, whenever a child is found murdered, and God forbid these things happen from time to time, even in our own times, various pedophiles do terrible things to children, then the regular peasantry looks for someone to blame, and Jews are often the most convenient target. Another aspect of pogrom violence through the ages is something that is associated specifically with Eastern Europe and tends to have a much more economic component, the most significant of which are the pogroms that occurred under the rule of Bohdan Chmelnytsky, shown here, who rebelled against Polish overlords from Ukraine in the middle of the 17th century. And the period known as Gzeiras Tach V'Tach in Hebrew history, the evil decree of 1648-49, represents a period when Ukrainian peasants rebelled not only against Polish overlords who were dominating them economically and religiously, but also, and perhaps more significantly, against their Jewish leaseholders living in the local villages. This is largely due to an economic system called the arrenda, which was prominent in Eastern Europe, and Jews were very much involved in it, where you had absentee landowners living typically in northern Poland who owned large estates called latifundia in Ukraine, and they sent the Jewish populations to the south to manage those large landholdings and specifically to collect taxes on them from the local population. The Jews were kind of like the leading edge of the spear of Polish domination. And when the Ukrainians rebelled, it's not surprising that the Jews felt their rebellion most savagely. So in 1648-49, you had a series of pogroms recorded in the memoir Yeven Metzula by Nathan of Hanover that devastated the Jewish population in Ukraine and Poland. Also related to this and related as well to Kishinev was the institution of called propinacja, which was essentially the monopoly granted to these Jewish leaseholders to produce and sell alcohol, often on credit with a heavy rate of interest. And so, you know, we have these kind of, you know, folk stories with the Jews living at the local kretschma or at an inn where they could serve alcohol to the happy-go-lucky peasants. And that's kind of like a rosy look at what was actually going on, where the only place that you could legally get alcohol was at a Jewish establishment. And if you bought it on credit and you ran up big tab, hard time came around and you had to pay it back, you can imagine how the peasants would resent the system. It also was an extremely noxious system because the Polish landlords living far away would set the rates that they would demand from their Jewish leaseholders. And if the Jews were successful in producing the taxes, that only incentivized the Poles to demand more and more every year, increasing the yoke on the local peasantry, who eventually rose up in violence. And that's essentially the kind of violence that you see in Eastern Europe, pogrom violence that is associated very closely with that economic relationship. The 19th century, however, you see a dramatic uptick in pogroms. As you can see from this map, a tremendous number of pogroms just washed over the Pale of Settlement, which is the region outlined in red, which is the region where Jews were allowed to live in the former Russian Empire. Bessarabia is right on the lower left of this region. And these pogroms were a little different. They were occasioned on a political moment when Tsar Alexander II was assassinated by socialists. A bomb was thrown in his carriage and he was killed. He was known as the Tsar Liberator because he had liberated the peasants, somewhat more successfully, by the way, than Abraham Lincoln had emancipated the slaves in America, because Alexander II had at least given them some kind of land, whereas Lincoln was unable to give them their 40 acres and a mule. And many people felt that this moment of upheaval was a possibility for rebellion and for riot, and a rumor circulated that permission was given by the new Tsar, Alexander III, to beat the Jews for 3 days. And so you had this massive pogrom wave that lasted not 3 days, but 3 years. And the Russian Empire was simply unable to control it. They did not have the bureaucratic infrastructure movement to be able to put down this wave, and it led to a lot of changes among the Jewish population. But unlike the economic motives that were related to in the Arenda period, you see a lot more here the impact of industrialization, because many of the pogromists were associated with a particular piece of the economy. They were day laborers traveling from their homes in the not really day laborers, but casual laborers traveling from their homes in the countryside into the cities, where they were taking industrial blue collar jobs at an increasing level. They were single 18 to 24 year olds, and they were prone to alcoholism, prone to violence as they rode the railways. In fact, you can often link the specific progress of the pogroms by looking at the individual railway stops that were constructed throughout Eastern Europe. But this pogrom wave really convinced Jews that they had to do something different about their situation. It promoted the start of many new political movements, and in particular promoted emigration to other countries, including, as you can see here, 1.750 million Jews who moved to America between 1881 and 1917 from the Pale of Settlement, 70,000 who chose to go to Canada because they have national health insurance, a quarter of a million moving to Western Europe, and 45,000 moving to both Israel, then the Yishuv, and 45,000 to South Africa. But let us return specifically to Kishinev, because we have to understand that in greater context. And before I begin, let's try another poll. The many people, and so 73% of you have already said that you, hang on a sec, I've got to unshare my screen. Oh no, I can find it up here, sorry. Many of you have said that you're familiar with the Kishinev pogrom, so you're probably laboring under the notion that the Russian government organized this particular attack on the Jews. And I hope my tone of voice is not giving it away, but it looks like the polls, the results are coming in now. Let's give it just another 10 seconds. It is widely believed, it has been widely believed for a long time, that the Russian government specifically organized the pogrom. And I see responses are still coming in. See how it goes. Okay, I'm going to stop right now because I think I've already given away the answer here. 55% of you believe that the Russian government did not organize the pogrom. And in fact, that seems to be the scholars' consensus right now. There is no evidence that the Russian government started that pogrom. Not to say that they were not amenable to the violence against Jews. There were definitely very anti-Semitic elements in the Tsar's court. Nicholas II was an avid member of the Black Hundreds, for example, a notoriously anti-Semitic organization. But the actual organization of the pogrom seems to have been beyond them, as we shall see. Let's go back to the lecture proper then. So let's look at Kishinev in 1903. What did it look like? This is what it looks like today. It is located, as I mentioned, in Bessarabia, this kind of like rump state of the Russian Empire in the lower left corner. It had the highest infant mortality in the Russian Empire. The entire region only had 114 paved miles of roads. So it was like a really, really backward part of the Russian Empire, especially so that it was in the European part of Russian Empire. It made Central Asia look modern. Literacy on a general level was 39%, which is quite low, but that's also including the Jews. And Jews tend to be have a much higher literacy rate than the surrounding populations. I don't know the specific breakdown for Jews in Kishinev, but in that same survey for the Russian Empire overall, Jews had approximately 60% literacy, which is shocking to us perhaps because, you know, we think of Jews as being 100% literate, but at the turn of the 20th century, 60% was pretty good, especially women were also about 40% literate in any language. Population was 110,000 and about one third of the city was Jewish. This is very typical of Eastern European urban settlements. Jews tended not to live as farmers, even though we've all seen Fiddler on the Roof. It's very unusual for Jews to be engaged in farming. Even Tevye, who looks like a farmer, but he's actually a dairyman, was somewhat unusual. So Jews tended to gravitate to mid-sized events where they were involved primarily in commerce and as the working poor. It was an impoverished Jewish community as well. The Passover charitable activities in Kishinev were very active and relied very heavily on donations from abroad. But there was also a wealthier class of Jews who tended to be newcomers to Kishinev, who came for the kind of, new opportunities, particularly in the area of speculation and some sebrosa activities like smuggling outside of the Russian Empire. So there were a few families that were of high wealth in Kishinev, but for the most part, Jews in Kishinev were backwards, poor, and comparatively speaking, illiterate. The immediate causes of the pogrom are associated with this man, Pavel Khrushchevan, who was actually not in Kishinev at the time of the pogrom, so he himself did not light the match, but he definitely prepared the kindling. He was the publisher of a notoriously anti-Semitic work newspaper, a daily called Besarabets, which was laughable in its content. It had about 8 pages that would be produced every day. Most of the content would be written by Khrushchevan himself, often under pseudonyms. It was a melange of conspiracy theory and resentment and anti-Semitism that actually had a fairly wide reading in Bessarabia itself. The magazine newspaper was called Bessarabets. He was impoverished and actually he was forced to sell his newspaper, but he seemed to have not relinquished control of it even after he sold it. And he ran it out of 2 printing presses that he actually housed in his cramped apartment and had to be sued to actually release the receipts that he was getting from subscriptions. He eventually made his way to St. Petersburg, where he would have a second act in his career, and we will turn to that towards the end of this lecture, a very notorious negative impact on Jews. But it was his constant rabble-rousing in Bessarabets that definitely fanned the flames of anti-Semitism in the region and made it ready for a much more significant anti-Semitic attack. There's also a fascinating aspect to his life that was brought up in Dr. Zipperstein's book. He actually managed to get a hold of Khrushchev's early writings as an adolescent, his own journal. And it seemed that Khrushchev had a very conflicted inner life. He was, you'll have to read the book to read about it, but it's a dark history. Now, what has specifically happened in Kishinev is that earlier in the year, the pogrom erupted in April, but earlier in March of that year, in nearby Dubasari, a very small town of 5,000 people, about half of them were Jews, there was a blood libel ritual. In March of that year, a 15-year-old boy was found, a Christian boy. He was murdered by multiple stab wounds. And there was a rumor that perhaps he had been killed as a result of a blood libel, meaning that the Jews of Dubosari had killed this 15-year-old in order to drink his blood on the upcoming holiday of Passover. The authorities who investigated it, and amazingly, the Russian authorities took blood libel seriously as a charge. Only a few years later, they would haul before the Kiev court a young fixer named Mendel Bayliss. I was about to say Bernard Malamud, who of course wrote a book about him called The Fixer. And the Russian government would actually prosecute cases on the grounds that Jews had killed this person for his blood. And among the ridiculous kinds of evidence that was submitted was the victim completely drained of blood or not? And apparently, if he was, this was somehow an indication that it was in fact a blood libel. In any case, the jury in Kiev of peasants was unconvinced that Mendel Bayliss was a blood libel murderer, and they actually allowed him to go free. And the same thing happened in Dubosari, where the local authorities felt that it was not a blood libel. And in fact, they had significant evidence that a cousin of this 15-year-old who had, the 15-year-old was actually living with his grandfather and was named as his heir in his will. And a jealous cousin murdered the 15-year-old in order that he would be the beneficiary of his grandfather's will. A sad story, but an entirely mundane one, not at all associated with blood libel. There were some minor riots at the time, no deaths. It was just kind of like a local upset over this particular charge, and it came to nothing. However, many people believe that the Russian government had somehow interfered at about this point to start a pogrom in nearby Kishinev, and they brought as proof for this a letter that was apparently signed by Vyacheslav Vonpleve, who was a very high minister in the Russian government. Vonpleve, of course, denied that he had, well, actually, I'm not sure that he actually had the opportunity to deny it, but historians have been unable to prove that this was, in fact, an accurate document that came from the Russian government. And in fact, the preponderance of the evidence suggests that it is nothing more than a forgery that was used to try and leverage the violence in Kishinev as an anti-government attack. And in fact, it was much more base human motives at the root of the violence. The pogrom itself went like this. It occurred on Easter Day in 1903. Easter is unfortunately often associated with pogroms for several reasons. It typically happens in springtime, and most pogroms happen in the spring or early summer when the weather is right for outdoor altercations. Unfortunately, pogroms tend to be a seasonal activity like the flu. Secondly, associated with Easter, in the Eastern Orthodox Church in particular, they rely very heavily on the liturgy that is inspired by a church father named St. John Chrysostom. And Chrysostom, the Greek term for his name literally means the golden mouth, was especially anti-Semitic and included many diatribes against Jews in his sermons. And these sermons are often worked into the Easter sermons, particularly in the Eastern Church. So you can imagine Christians coming spilling out of their churches, and after hearing the priests speak about the depredations of the Jews and so on. And then you add to that the idea of the mysterious behavior of the Jews on Passover with their, you know, very particular demands for clean cutlery and dishes, and they have to get rid of all kinds of things in their house, and then they all drink 4 cups of red wine. Where does that wine come from? Is it actually wine? Is it not perhaps the blood of Christian children? So all of these things come together, the good weather, the pastoral preaching, the mysterious holiday of Passover, not to mention, of course, that Easter, you know, commemorates the crucifixion of the founder of Christianity, and then, of course, later his resurrection, that all of these things tie together into a toxic stew that eventually results in violence on many occasions. In Kishinev in particular, it began with children. Children hooligans, you know, you think it's unfortunate. I'm reminded of the kind of things that were going on, particularly in Brooklyn over this in the spring, when children were like knocking hats off the heads of Hasidim in Brooklyn, or punching them from behind and things like that. But hooligans walking around began to throw stones at Jews who were walking in the local parks. And it was on a Sunday, so it was a day off, and Jews were in the neighborhood. And there's also a suspicious number of seminary students. And I'm not talking here about Fruma and Shendel. I'm talking about Russian Orthodox seminary students with their distinctive clothing. These would be teenagers for the most part, who were also involved in some of these early kind of harassments. And it seemed to have kind of ballooned out of control from these very small level incidents and moved from there to more brutal altercations on the street, which were fueled by alcohol. Easter is a time when a lot of the peasants would have come into the large city to hear the sermons. And then when alcohol was flowing in the streets and Jews were associated with alcohol, as I mentioned earlier, many of the liquor stores in Bessarabia and in Kishinev were run by Jews. And in fact, they were the first to be looted. Many of the stores that were attacked, like alcohol stores, the pogromists would walk in, would demand free drinks, and if the owner refused to comply, or even if he complied but only partially, like samples, out of fear for his life, then the looting started. And it seems to have been something that snowballed out of control. The final stage was home invasions, where masses of looters, at the end of this, 900 people would be arrested. So you get a sense of the scale of participation in this. If 900 are arrested, and you assume that at least 700 of them deserve to be arrested, and at least 200 or 300 of them, you know, got away without being arrested, it's a very large number of people who are roaming the streets of this mid-sized city looking for Jewish homes. Jews tended to live in courtyards, kind of like buildings. You see in Eastern Europe, they tend to live in these kind of courtyards where there are several homes on multiple floors around a central courtyard. They would burst into the outer doors and they would ransack apartment after apartment over the course of 2 days. There were two nights in particular of violence. And at this point, we have to turn to something that's especially difficult with the Kishinev pogrom that sets it apart qualitatively, perhaps, from many other pogroms, and that is the number of rapes of women, which is perhaps one of the most difficult aspects of the entire pogrom and of pogroms in general. And I have to say here, this is one of the areas where I really felt that Dr. Zipperstein's book is especially valuable. I myself studied pogroms for my PhD dissertation. I wrote a book on the pogrom waves that occurred in Ukraine from 1917 to 1920. And I spent a lot of time reading pogrom testimonials. And there's no question that rapes are a very large part of this kind of violence. It's focused primarily in material damage and theft and looting. And then after that is rape. And then only after that do you have murder. Physical violence is definitely part of it. But it seems that when the crowds are loosed like this on a civilian population, rapes are the largest single personal harm crime that come out of these attacks. But how do you handle these kinds of attacks as a historian? How do you mention these? There is such a huge stigma attached to women who are raped, particularly in the beginning of the 20th century. when their marriage prospects could change. There's a very different attitude than there is in the Me Too movement that we have today. Historians have really been uncertain how to cope with it. In the next slide, I'm going to share with you three distinct aspects of this, but there's no question that there's a tremendous number of rapes that are going on in the Kishinev pogrom, and that's perhaps the most salient feature that people would have remembered from the pogrom itself. It may not be what we receive in the written word, but anyone who was there at the time, that's what would have stood out perhaps more than anything else, even more than the 49 Jews who were murdered, in my humble opinion. There were some specific cruelties associated with the Kishinev pogrom, some of which proved not to have been real. For example, there's a widespread story that a pregnant woman was eviscerated and pillows were stuffed in her body afterward. There seems to be no contemporaneous account of this, which undercuts the credibility of that story. On the other hand, there are actual contemporaneous accounts of men who were murdered by having nails driven into their head repeatedly. What also is shocking about the Kishinev pogrom, which is not shocking to all pogroms in general, but is different from the 1881 pogroms where, you know, tend to be people coming from outside. In many, many of the cases, the victims knew their attackers. They called out to them by name. They pleaded with them as they were being raped, please don't do this to me, and so on. But this was really a crime of neighbor against neighbor more than any other pogrom that had been recorded previously. So let us look at the impact of this pogrom, and specifically, we'll get to the reactions, the rape issue shortly. Why does Kishinev have such a great impact compared to so many other pogroms, which in many ways would have been very similar in scope and scale? If you look just 2 years later in 1905, there's horrible pogroms that occur in the same area with much larger damage. And in 1919, by conservative estimates, 30,000 Jews lost their lives to pogroms. So what is it about Kishinev that stands out so much? A lot of it has to do with the work of one particular individual. Here you can see, by the way, the New York Times even reports the Kishinev massacre. It's this individual here, Jacob Bernstein Kogan, who was a Jew living in Kishinev at the time, and he recognized the dire need after these two nights of violence to get the word out to Jews around the world. And he banged on the doors of wealthy Jews, demanding that they pay for telegrams to be sent around the world of the violence that had happened in Kishinev. And it is his indefatigable activity in which he literally spent an entire night and then weeks afterwards hammering home the message abroad that this is something that happened in Kishinev that attracted the attention of many people around the world, including the Hearst Empire of newspapers that sent out a journalist specifically to cover the region and to give it much greater attention in Western Europe. Because otherwise, think about it, this is like something that happens in a backward part of Russia, and it's true 49 people died, but they're Jews anyways. Why would the world really care about one little riot like this? Why would it have such a reverberation if it were not for the fact that someone like Jacob Bernstein Kogan saw it as his duty to get this word out, and he was incredibly successful. So let's look at three reactions specifically to Kishinev, and I want to return to the issue of rapes in particular. The first reaction is from Michael Devitt, who is shown here. He was actually an Irish journalist, also a politician. In fact, in Ireland, he's known much more for his political activity. But he was sent by the Hearst newspaper empire to Kishinev to provide a story for their readers, based largely on the Kogan Bernstein telegrams. David did an amazing job. He interviewed people for weeks, very detailed interviews, and he not only composed a tremendous newspaper account, he ultimately wrote a book about Kishinev that had phenomenal impact. And he wrote it in English, which meant that it reached a much wider audience. And so from a journalistic perspective, he provided the Western world with an insight into what happened in Kishinev at a level of granular detail and with an extremely literate pen that made a tremendous impact, as we shall see, even as far as America. And then, of course, more closely related to Israel is the activity of Chaim Nachman Bialik, Israel's poet laureate, who was actually sent to Kishinev, he was a young man at the time, by Ahad Ha'am, to provide essentially the same thing that Michael David had did. He was sent there as a journalist to try and provide some kind of report. Like David, he interviewed for weeks, and then he repaired to write his account, but he completely abandoned his original plan that was directed by Ahad Ha'am, and instead he wrote a poem called In the City of Slaughter, which was incredibly powerful. And it became part of the standard curriculum of the Israeli school system, both in the Yishuv era, and then of course in Israel proper, as one of the great works of poetry in the entire Jewish canon. He has been compared to the great Paitanim of medieval age and even into the ancient world for his description of the violence in Kishinev. Now, it is a very problematic point because David, on the one hand, when he had to deal with the impact of rapes in Kishinev, he tended to allude to it in kind of Lashon Naki in Hebrew. He used euphemism by and large to describe it. In other words, he would refer in passing to large-scale violations of the daughters of Israel. And so if you were reading David's account, you would get a sense of the violence. You would get a sense of the quote-unquote manly violence of attacks, of physical beatings, and of course the smaller number of murders, but you would not get the sense of what it meant to be raped. You did not have a full, literate, evocative introduction to what that unique experience was. Bialik, on the other hand, he went there, and he went there in a very big way. He wrote from the male perspective, but he depicted the Jewish males of Kishinev as being excessively cowardly, of hiding behind doors, watching their wives and daughters and mothers be raped, and wondering and praying to God that they should not be discovered. He portrayed Jewish men as emasculated and as sacrificing their women folk to these pogromists. It is a damning criticism that's very, very hard to read, even in English translation. And it gives people a moment of pause when they read Bialik, because Jewish men come off as incredibly insensitive cowards. More than that, he takes aim directly at religion. And he talks in his poem, The City of Slaughter, about Jewish Kohanim, who are technically not permitted to be married to women who have had experience with non-Jews. I'm not going to venture into the halachic aspects of this, but these Jewish men, after their wives are raped by these pogromists, they run to their rabbi and ask him, is my wife permitted to me or must I divorce her? And in fact, the contemporaneous accounts indicate that 11 women were divorced immediately after Kishinev, much as Bialik recorded. When you compare his personal notes from Kishinev to his poem, it's very clear that he borrowed directly from the language of many of the victims of the pogroms themselves and of the observers, in some cases, the husbands of the wives who were so violated. It is a very, very difficult poem to read, and it takes issue not only with Jewish manhood and Jewish courage, but also even with God himself, wondering why God does not step in to stop this. And there is a final approach taken by Shimon Dubno, who was the great historian of Eastern Europe. And Kishinev had reverberated so strongly within the English-speaking world that he was actually approached, and he actually completed a major project, a three-volume English language history of the Jews in Eastern Europe that is still one of the main sources used today as a survey text on the great scope of the history of the Jews in this region. And he also treated the rapes, but again, in a more scholarly tone, he used much of David's approach with the kind of euphemisms, but he buried much of the actual concrete data. how many women were raped, for example, is something that Dubnow does not deal with in his sources. So these are kind of like the reactions on a literary level, which had tremendous impact, as we shall see, but they are nevertheless problematic. And I would like to share my final poll with you now, which looks at this particular question. And I'm asking mainly because I personally don't know. I had to make some decisions for my own research on this, but the question is, which approach is the best to record the violence against women in the Kishinev pogrom? Should we, you know, use a journalistic approach with allusions? Should you use poetry with highly emotive response? Or should we use scholarship and try to have a dispassionate approach to them? What's the best way to try and relate this to a larger audience? It's a very difficult question. I simply do not know the answer myself. We have, everyone is voting now and the numbers are going up and down. I don't know if, Rabbi Goldberg, can you see the poll as it's going or is it just me? Oh, you can. Okay, so everyone can see people are reacting to this and we do not, everyone seems to be kind of locked in the same conundrum that I have as well. I was considering actually reading parts of In the City of Slaughter in this lecture, but some of it is just so painful that I simply could not bear to do it. Perhaps in the question and answer part, we might return to it. But I think it's about time we stop this. We have 60% voting. That's good enough for an American election. And what do we have here? So the results are pretty much evenly divided. 27% prefer the journalistic approach to describe this kind of violence against women. 35% prefer Bialik's poetry with emotive treatment of rapes. And 38%, the very slight lead there, prefers Dubnow's scholarship with a dispassionate discussion. Very difficult question. Thank you for helping me with your opinion on this. Unfortunately, I have a feeling I'll probably come back to this question in my own research. Now, let us look at some of the reverberations outside of the Jewish community. One of the lesser known aspects of the Kishinev pogrom is that many Jews in America were so moved by the stories that were being circulated by people like Michael David, by the poetry of Bialik, and later by the scholarship of Dubnow, that they looked around themselves and they said, wait a second, we can't allow this to happen to any people in the world. And this was an era, right at the turn of the 20th century, where lynching was still a very pronounced phenomenon. And so a woman named Anna Strunsky, who was herself a native of Kishinev, who was living in America at the time, a Jewish woman, married to a non-Jew, she said, we absolutely have to take up this cause here in America. And who needs it most? Not the Jews, but African Americans. And her husband, with her urging, founded the NAACP directly as a result of the impact of Kishinev. They wanted to do something about the kind of mob violence that people would suffer anywhere, and they saw it's happening in America, so they specifically connected that experience of Kishinev to what they saw in the African-American community. And together with two others, he wasn't the only person who founded the NAACP. But it was not only this that we see, this goes on, it becomes a trope really as the foundational principle in Jewish thought for much of the 20th century, this identification with African Americans. We see it very strongly, for example, in the poetry of Abel Meeropol, who wrote a very haunting lyric called Strange Fruit that was inspired by a lynching that occurred right around the time of Kishinev. And Billie Holiday performed it in an absolutely glorious version. The song, if you're not familiar with it, speaks of strange fruit hanging from the trees, blood on the leaves and things like that. And it's referring, of course, to the hangings of African Americans and lynchings that happened at an astounding frequency here in these shores. So the Kishinev had a very direct impact on Jews involved in the early founding of the NAACP and of this kind of linkage between Jewish causes and African-American causes. It's only begun to break down really in the 1990s, the Crown Heights riot and so on. And there's a lot more to be said about that, but beyond the scope of our discussion. The last chapter is unfortunately something that we have to return to from the beginning. You'll recall that I introduced you to Pavel Khrushchevan, who was the author and editor of the Bessarabitz newspaper that laid the foundation of the pogrom. He moved to St. Petersburg. He was not actually in Kishinev at the time of the pogrom. And there he penned under a pseudonym and privately published in serial form a notorious document called the Protocols of the Elders of Zion, which is perhaps the most notorious anti-Semitic book ever written. And unfortunately, there are a lot of competitors for that title. Essentially, he claimed to have discovered the minutes of a meeting of the so-called Elders of Zion, a fictional group, meeting in the Prague cemetery and laying out their plans to dominate the world. It was loosely plagiarized from an 18th century French work of all places, but it was condensed into a bullet point form that even though it went on for hundreds of pages, it could be condensed to one basic set of messages that could be easily adapted and in fact has been adapted many times until the present day. The basic idea is that the Jews have an innate hatred for the rest of the world, and they want to use that misanthropy to dominate the world through technology, control of the media, control of the banks. These things probably sound familiar because unfortunately these ideas are very much circulating in common discourse today on many social media channels and things like that. It became an immediate hit. It was later printed in book form, and it's been translated into multiple languages. Here's a from 1930, The Invisible World Government, the Jewish Program to Subjugate the World. Here is a French language version actually published in the Vichy regime, The Jewish Peril. And you can see the imagery is very similar, right? In the Spanish version, you have the Jewish capitalist with the waistcoat and the watch fob crushing the globe in his claws, and blood flows from it as he gleefully looks on. Same thing here with sticking his fingers into the globe and it's bleeding. You see the corpses underneath. Here is an Arabic version that was produced, I believe, in Kuwait just recently. And of course, we have modern versions even today. So with that, I'm going to conclude my remarks on Kishinev. It is a relatively small moment of violence when viewed over the grand perspective of Jewish history. Even within the perspective of pogrom violence, it's not anywhere near the largest. But it is perhaps the most significant because it set a tone for how Jews understood themselves as a people in exile. Many of them chose to remove themselves from exile and join the young Yishuv in formation. Many of them, for example, here in America, chose to energize their activity on behalf of other oppressed peoples like the African Americans with the NAACP and so on. But it had strong reverberations throughout all of Jewish history, and we continue to deal with the aftermath to this day. I want to thank you very much for your attention. I can see from the attendee list that actually pretty much everyone held on right till the very end, which is a testament to your fortitude. But let me turn it over to Rabbi Goldberg.
Dr. Abramson, I would say it's really a testament to your scholarship and teaching style, which is just wonderful. Not much to say after a presentation like that. It was thorough, informative, and very sad. But thank you very much. It looks like one or two people raised their hands. Do you want to take a question? Do you want to?
Of course, I think we should. No one has written in any questions. You know, you have the Q&A feature there where you can write in a question if you prefer.
Yeah, so here there's someone from my shul, Bernie Rab. I'm gonna allow him to talk. Here we go. Bernie, you can speak now. You unmute your own mic. Bernie?
I think you may have to unmute him.
Okay, unmuted. Bernie, try one more time.
I'm muting myself.
Good, we can hear you now.
Okay, I just wondered if Dr. Abramson is aware that one of the results of the Kishinev pogrom was that Theodore Roosevelt appointed the first Jew as an American cabinet member. His name was Oscar Strauss, And President Roosevelt actually announced, Theodore Roosevelt, he actually announced that he did so to show the world how we thought of our Jews. He was so upset with the reports of what happened in Kishinev. I wonder if Dr. Abramson had ever read that.
I had not read that. Thank you for sharing that fact. That's fascinating.
His name was Oscar Strauss. And in fact, there is an Oscar Strauss today. Oscar Strauss, what's his last name? I forget. Who has been the chairman of the New York Philharmonic and still now the chairman emeritus. He is aware of that origin of his name.
Wow.
That's an interesting input.
Fascinating. Thank you.
Wonderful. Okay. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Abramson, again. And we look forward to hosting you in the future. Perhaps there'll be an opportunity to talk about something more uplifting, happier in our shul's relationship with you. But we are definitely davening that this be the last Tisha B'Av that we have to commemorate in the exile. But perchance that we are still here next year, I think everyone is already looking forward to your very worthwhile lectures. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Rabbi, we are getting a couple other questions. Would you mind if I just...
Please, with great pleasure.
So someone named Anonymous Attendee asks a very important question that I'm glad that it came up. Despite the popular conception represented by Bialik's poem, is there any indication that some Jews did fight back during the pogrom? Is there indications that after the pogrom, Jews improved their ability to locally self-defend? So I'm glad the question was raised because it's a significant one. And in fact, yes, there is. Jews were not totally passive during the Kishinev pogrom. We have multiple instances, especially early on in the pogrom, where Jews were able to fight back and pogrom is scattered. But once the pogrom has a significant amount of inertia, then you know a few Jews fighting back simply are overwhelmed. It is interesting to note that when they finally brought in the troops, when the mayor of Kishinev ordered troops in, they cleaned this up in a couple of hours. It was not a big deal at all, even though 900 people were arrested, which is an amazing number. I don't know where they put them all. But Jews did, in fact, attempt to fight back. There are multiple reports of that. More often, though, that fighting back was defensive, like trying to hold off pogromists from the front door. And then once the front door is breached, then they're overwhelmed and they're attacked themselves. And the second part of the question, indications after the pogrom, Jews improved their ability to locally self-defend? Absolutely. There is a huge wave of support for organization of Jews and self-defense units. Vladimir Jabotinsky, who we spoke about actually with your Kehila a while ago, he was one of the first translators of Bialik's poem into Russian, and he used it as a strong kind of like a whip to motivate Jews to get involved in self-defense, which he was involved in Odessa in particular. Odessa is very nearby. So Kishinev was kind of a turning point for Jews saying, no one is going to protect us unless we protect ourselves. I wish I had mentioned that earlier. Shelley Sanders mentioned that she really enjoyed this presentation. My grandmother escaped a later pogrom, which inspired my interest in Kishinev pogrom. I just wanted to mention that my first novel, Rachel's Secret, is set during the Kishinev pogrom and received a starred review and book list. Might be of interest to viewers. Okay, Shelley Sanders, Rachel's Secret. It looks fascinating. Noah Perlis, hi, how are you? Nice to see you in my text. Can I identify the painting behind me? This is David Roberts' 1873 depiction of the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem. I thought it was appropriate. I try to use it as a backdrop for some of my staff meetings to set the mood. Doesn't quite work. Are there similar news coverage of the 1900 Yekaterinoslav pogrom? Unfortunately, no, not even close. Yekaterinoslav was actually quite far away, and we don't have anything like Michael Devitt going to the other end of Ukraine for that. Kishinev is perhaps the best covered pogrom, probably in history, in my humble opinion. Okay, sorry, back to you, Rabbi.
Okay, that's it. You're wonderful, Dr. Abramson. L'shana haba b'Yerushalayim.
Amen, amen. Next year in Jerusalem.